Is your company one of the 93% surveyed, indicating they are ineffective at forming strategy? Companies successful in forming strategy use a strategic decision process. Foresight Business Consulting is developing an online course that teaches a new strategic decision process. You can enroll as a founding member at a fabulous discount during Foresight's crowdfunding campaign. Visit the Lean Strategy Masters campaign page at bit.ly/LeanStrategyMasters or search for Lean Strategy Masters on Indiegogo.com.
Savvy Business Radio runs in syndication on 8 AM/FM stations nationwide, including iHeartRadio and 6 podcasting platforms. To find out about our paid sponsorship opportunities or to become a guest and find out how we can help you get your message out in a bigger way, call 732-474-7375 or email Christina at SavvyBusinessRadio.com.
We're joined today by founder and CEO of Thrive Partners, Lou Diamond. He is the master connector and has over 25 years' experience in sales, relationship management, business development, and executive coaching. Today, Lou shares with us how to build deep connections with empathy and authenticity that will have your business thriving. Find out more about Lou and Thrive at thrivepartners.net. Hi, Lou. Welcome to Savvy Business Radio. How are you today?
I'm doing great, Christina. How are you?
I'm doing fabulous. I'm super excited to have you out here today. We're going to talk about connecting. You are the master connector. And this is a very timely and important message for today, not only for connecting with your prospective clients, but also internally, connecting with your employees. If you've hired employees, the importance of being able to connect with people around you for business and for personal. One person had told me, she's a speaker, and she said, people think that, you know, you're a speaker when you stand up on stage and give your message. You're a speaker 24/7. You're leaving a voicemail for someone. You're leaving your message with someone. You're connecting with someone right there, right then. So I just want to thank you, Lou, for coming to Savvy. Share with our audience a little bit about your background. What brought you to being the super connector?
I like that title within that. I like to say, Christina, that it took me a long time to figure it out. But I was put on this planet to work with the most amazing people and make them even more amazing. And my company, Thrive, does exactly that. Now, that has taken years of working in sales, consulting, coaching, and all of that combined. The common skill across all of that is my ability to connect with people. And when a few years back, I was actually at a business conference, and you know, there are certain people that you run into in life that are naturally social in those type of environments. If it's networking, if it's a party, the person who seems to know everybody, I've always been that kind of a person. I'm the person that seems to just, you know, forget 6 degrees of separation. It's more like, you know, a sixth of a degree of a separation. I'll know everybody who's within that. And a lot of that is innate and my lovely, charming personality. But the other parts of it are also my ability to care and connect with those that I'm trying to meet. And a client of mine several years ago actually had brought it to my attention that what I did seemed to be different and wanted to know, have I been able to map out exactly how I'm able to connect so quickly and so, I guess, deeply with the people that I meet and work with? And that's actually where Master the Art of Connecting came about, which kind of spelled out how to go about and how you need to be when you need to connect with someone.
That's amazing. And it's so true. There's more to it than just saying, hello, my name is so-and-so, and now here's my business card, and let's do business. What I just picked up from you more than anything is that really that caring that comes forward from your heart outward. And I think that's what people feel and actually gravitate towards. Would you agree that that's kind of the essence of how you really connect deeply with people?
So what we go in the book is what I call the connecting core. And just like, Christina, when you want to go work out or do an exercise, what does every personal trainer tell you need to strengthen? Your physical core, right?
You know, the core.
The So, you know, you've got all these abs workouts and things in the middle of your body, right? Yeah. Well, to go out and connect with people, I've actually broken it down that there actually is a connecting core.
Ooh.
There are muscles that are inside yourself that basically are the skills and things that you need to work on to actually, when you meet someone, to connect with them more easily, understand them more often. They're like, since I wasn't consulting for a very long time, we'd like to make acronyms. So we ended up making an acronym. And the four muscles of the connecting core, I call the SAFE, S-A-F-E.
Huh.
And the S is your super why. The A is authenticity.
Uh-huh.
The F is a fearless mindset. And the E is empathy, embracing the power of empathy. So to your point, each one of those things you need to work on to be able to really connect with your target. And when you, some people have different aspects of those muscles that are stronger. You've probably met people that really know who they are on this earth, and they're very authentic and real, and they are really caring, but they are scared out of their own shoes, and they have to work on sometimes their fearless mindset.
Yeah.
Going in and speaking is not necessarily their comfortable thing. So working on that muscle is something that they need to do to be a little bit more fearless and kind of move through their fears into courage. And those are the types of things that you need to work on to go connect with people. So it's not just one thing. It's that combination of those four that not only enable you to go connect outwardly with somebody, but when someone has a really strong connecting core, people are drawn into them. It's almost the people want to connect with these people. Literally, if they walk into a room, these are the people that you actually want to meet and want to learn from, because you're going to gain something from them, just as you're able to give for them.
Now, it's interesting when you said fearlessness, because that's what pops up for me. I remember even in high school or grammar school, if there was a party, I'd be hiding in the back. And even as an adult, I'll go to a networking party or event. I just seriously don't want to be there. I love people, but I don't like being front and center. I like them being front and center, not myself. Where does that come from? Is it like we're scared of being rejected? What is that about?
Everybody has their own reason for why they have their fears. You know, at Thrive, I actually coach, you know, some top level executives. They're still dealing with some of these fears. There's one client who actually was this top salesperson who actually used to be afraid to speak in public. And, you know, a lot of it might be the fear of rejection. That one of my favorite ones is the imposter syndrome. That's a fear where people are afraid they're going to be found out that they don't know everything. And if they're speaking in front of public, in front of a group of people, that feeling of not knowing all the right answers, which, by the way, no one knows the right answers, and nobody knows everything. So this is a common thing that we help them move through their fears. It's just the perception of that. And everyone is different. And you're right. There are people that are more naturally fearless in certain areas, and you know, it's just understanding the fear. That's the most important thing. Whenever I say fearless mindset, it's not that there is no fear and it's not there. It's just knowing what holds you back, recognizing it, and know how to move through it. That is important. Sometimes people can be motivated by the fears that they have, and they could use them almost as a trampoline to launch themselves to the next level.
Well, that's great. That's fabulous. And we talked before the interview. I really loved your story, by the way. Before the interview, we talked about what led you to even write your book when you were at a party. Share that, because I really, really like that story about how the person you were with really noticed your gifts and talents.
So I was at a trade show, at some common trade show, just like anybody else, with a very industry-specific technology-based conference. And I was with the CEO, who was definitely more on the, I want to say he was an internal focused person. He just wasn't as outgoing and in a networking environment. And he knew he needed to meet a lot of people at this particular environment to help grow his business. So I actually was working with him and went with him. And within a few minutes, I felt like I was a kid in a candy shop, you know, at those types of events. I could find lots of interesting people and go meet them. And I'm fascinated. And I was there on behalf of this gentleman and his company. So we were looking at his business and trying to understand, you know, how they can help all these different companies. That's kind of that power of empathy. You know, what are the thing? What are your problems that you're experiencing? What technologies could you use to improve your business?
Yeah.
So I was going around and meeting all these different people, and I was bringing them over, actually introducing them to my client. And a couple minutes after we had been there, and later that evening, he came up to me. He says, "How long have you known these people that you've met them? It seems like you've known them forever." And I go, "No, I really just met them a few minutes ago." And his comment was, "It seems like you've known them forever from the way that you've managed mm-hmm. to quickly connect with them." Wow. And later he had brought it up to my attention that whatever I do and whatever I'm doing, I need to share with others. Yeah. And that actually was the impetus for writing the book, was to share this skill, I guess, or the skill that many people have, yes. and just be able to codify it into a way that people know how to work on it. And I just came up with the term of the connecting core as what you need to focus on.
That's fabulous. And I'm thinking, though, when a lot of people go to networking events, I've heard past guests tell my audience that really you should have a plan of action when you go there so you know who to connect with. Is there a way to do that, to walk in a room and say, okay, those are the people who might be my tribe or I might be able to help? Do you have an action plan yourself, or you just kind of go in there and scope and just start talking to people here and there?
I'd say, Christina, it's a combination. I always like to know when I'm going to an event, there are certain types of people that we're looking forward to meet. But if you go in there basically saying, "I need to meet the CEO of this particular company," or "I need to talk to the head of marketing of this particular brand," mm-hmm. that type of an attitude, if you just go in with that laser focus, could distract you a little bit and could also, in many cases, make you come off too forward. Yeah. You should have a game plan who you're going after. And you should, I'm a big fan of less is more.
Ooh.
You want to have great quality meetings with people and make stronger connections. If you received 50 to 100 business cards at a trade show, mm-hmm. that's wonderful and that's great networking. If you make one connection with one particular partner or strategic target that you were seeking, that is way more valuable than all those 50 to 100 business cards combined. So,
yeah.
It's that type of a game plan. And I will tell you that it doesn't always map itself out. Just mm-hmm. last week, I was actually in Atlanta at a conference, and we had some intended targets that we were looking to meet. Uh-huh. And because of the way that we had been focused, this is me and a CEO of another client that I work with, we were so focused on making sure that we were delivering to certain people and that our message was right and that we would show how that we were going to help these targets that we were after, that other people started coming over and new business targets and prospects popped up from that. That's exactly what you're trying to do when you go to these events. It's hard because uh-huh. you've been to some of these.
Yeah.
There's so many people and it's so difficult to navigate. It's important to be there, but also to kind of pick your focus and not try to just get distracted by it, which is not easy. I always say, if you go to these events, try not to have the meetings in the event. Go grab a cup of coffee across the street. Mm-hmm. Go grab lunch that's not at the common lunch area where everybody's going to. Figure out how to maximize the time that you have there and meet these people as best as you can.
Yeah, and it would seem to me also to be flexible, because what happened there last week is that other opportunities opened up. You had your sights on this is where we're focused, but you were flexible when other opportunities presented itself, that you were, "Oh, okay, here's an interesting prospect. Let's go here. Let's see what's going to happen with this."
That's, you've just nailed it. That's the whole thing. That combination of a game plan and being flexible. You know, any good coach who coaches any sports team, this is true too. You know, you could come out with a great game plan. Something uh-huh. always, you know, changes. And if it went always perfect to plan, uh-huh. that would almost be too good. It just doesn't happen that way. There's the life and reality. Timing, sometimes conflicts.
Yeah.
I remembered I went to go meet someone recently at this networking event in New York City. And I didn't even know who was going to be on the attendee list, but I knew this one particular individual. And I ended up meeting 15 great people, 5 unbelievable connections I established from there. And I never got to meet the person that I initially intended to go meet. So sometimes the best laid plans, right?
Yeah, it's strange, Lou. I mean, I've had experiences where I've gone to a certain networking event and we have planned that this is probably the company or people we need to meet. And from that, I've met now clients that have been very loyal with us for years that we did not intend to meet. They were not really anyone we thought would be interested in working with us, doing advertising and such. But that's what I mean by flexibility, just opening it up. And also, we were willing to build that ongoing relationship. One such client has done business business with us, advertising over the past 4 years, at least 4 or 5 times, and sent countless people to us, which is fabulous because then it's word of mouth and referrals, which you always want to come your way. So we've met wonderful, great people from that one contact who sent several other contacts our way. So it's like a wonderful ripple in a pond.
Well, I love that description. And that's what you're that's what you're hoping for from your connection, that ripple and pond effect. If Christina, if you think of the two of us as like a little bit of an orb around us, and I kind of write this out, this is how I see people, by the way. Uh-huh. It's like we have our little orb and we have all of our assets that I see them almost as like virtual icons around you. Uh-huh. And when you go into these events, you're kind of looking at people and saying, oh, that person is from, I'll use an example. That person's from IBM and they used to come from one of the big four accounting firms and they specialize in this particular area. And you could kind of see that that way. And the master connectors look at that person and they don't think, oh my God, I need to incorporate that person into my world. Now that doesn't work with the safe. That would be too selfish. And that basically would say, what, those are only my needs. Uh-huh. The way you're going to connect is you have to understand what their needs are first.
Yes.
It's always about them.
Ooh, I love
so if
it.
You look at them and say, okay, you know what? I know that that person is looking for a new marketing firm in their role that they have right now. Let me introduce that person to someone that I could connect them to and bring them this way. And if you're addressing kind of think of it in that visual way of like saying, oh, they're missing this hole or they need to fill that box. And they need to focus on this particular area that will help make their world stronger. It's only going to make your world stronger. It's going to make other people that are connected to you even stronger. And that ripple effect that you were describing is helping each of these individuals grow. And that is the true power of connection.
Wow.
And why connecting is so much more powerful than the word networking. I just wrote a blog.
Yes.
Connecting over networking. I think the word networking is just being so overused. and I know that it's no different than the word sale.
Yeah.
There's no other word to describe sales.
And there's nothing wrong. It's not a dirty word, but it's become made a dirty word. It does. It's basically if someone needs something, you're giving it to them, and they're giving you a value set in the way of money. So it's not an evil thing. It's become a kind of dirty word sometimes, but really, just like networking, it's not, or connecting is really it's not a dirty word. What I love about this, and this recalls for me recently, two aspects that happened for us. One, a possible business owner that wanted to do business with us advertising, and I knew the type of business he was not a fit for our audience. So I told him, listen, I don't think we're going to be able to help you because we could put you before our audience, but I don't think it's going to get you any leads or anyone who is going to be interested in your type of business. So I sent him to a new radio program that I thought would be a better fit. And then we had an educator who came to us because part of our new Heartbeat of the World segment that we're going to do focuses on a lot of challenges going on around the U.S. and the world. And he's an educator. But his platform is very academia, really focusing on teachers talking to teachers. And I said, you know what? I think you would be a better fit for this education program. Bam, I connected the two. And then that way they can help each other. So I think that's what you're referring to, that it's always about the person you're meeting. How can you help them first? And it might not be you, but you sending them to somewhere else, not with the idea that, hey, I do for you, now you do for me. It's just that if you just put it out to the world that I'm here to serve, you will always be paid back, but maybe not by the same person or the same situation. It'll come back in another form sometimes.
Yeah, and they become part of your circle and part of your world.
Yes.
When you've helped somebody in that particular need, one, you are learning from them, and sometimes the connection is for yourself. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, the benefit of connecting with that person helps you directly.
Yeah.
And many instances, if you have a really strong connection, remember, getting back to that example of a sale, if I go and make one sale with somebody, that's great. It doesn't matter if it's $1, $100, $100,000, $1 million. That one sale, that's wonderful. You've made the sale. What we are looking for when we connect with targets is years of continuous sales in many different pieces. The sale just happens to happen because we have the strong connection with somebody.
Yeah.
So from a business perspective, we are looking to have relationships with people that there may not be the immediate need right now, but having that strong relationship with that person, they'll become a partner when it's most suitable and benefit for the two of you, for them and for you, your needs serving them. Absolutely. If we just go in and we say, oh, I have to meet this person because I need my numbers this year. I need to make that sale. I have to close it. We're only thinking of ourselves. That's from a coaching world, that's listening level one, only thinking about yourself.
Yeah.
Not listening level two, which is more focused listening on the person that you're focused on and working with them. That is the type of connecting that will lead to many, many more relationships with that person down the road.
And not only that, I've come to sense myself, and in the beginning when I was a little desperate doing that to others, I sense it when people do it to me, and I'm sure people sense it when I was desperate, that there's this sense of it's all about you, and it turns people off. It's icky. It's not fun. you want it to be a win-win at the end of the day. Yeah, you want to make a sale, but you also want it to be that you can actually help that person.
Christina, I've said it this way. If you've ever sat through a sales presentation and a firm comes in, and I talk about this one to the book because this really happened. I sat in on this company presenting their capabilities to another client. Uh-huh. And, they went through the regular PowerPoint deck, the PowerPoint march of death, as I used to call it. And here's our company. Here's who's worked for us. This is what we do. This is how we are going to help you and all the great things that our solution offers. And when you start to realize that they've gone through this whole presentation and they've never really addressed the most important person in the room, their target. And it doesn't matter who they've done great work for. It doesn't even matter what their name is, what their brand is. If they don't focus their message on how they're going to help that specific target that they're after, that prospect they're going to do business for, talking about yourself and your brand doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
The connection has to be that you're focused on their needs first. And if they then ask, well, what are the things that you've done and what can you do? Well, then you can open up the book and say, this is how we do what we do and how we would do it for you, as opposed to just the me, I, how we're so great, all of that type of a presentation. We want to get to that point that if we want them literally to have to make us open the PowerPoint slides so they can jump to the one that they're interested in seeing. And that's the type of relationship you want.
Yeah.
So you want to get to that particular point with any contact or connection that you want to deal with.
Absolutely. And now let's talk about, we talked about before the interview a little bit, the importance of internal connections, because people think, I have a business, now I've hired on some crew to help grow my business. And it's as important to have the outer connections with your clients, potential clients and such, but also with your internal staff. Explain a little bit about how important that is and how to build those connections.
So often, and specifically from a sales or an account management point of view, we are focused on communicating and listening to our targets and our clients' needs. We are looking outwardly of the company and trying to figure out how we can grow our business with those accounts. And we will have a really good sense of empathy for working with them. And sometimes we forget that we need to then flip that around and have that same focus and level, that important level of listening internally. This has become a big topic. We started talking about this before, Christina, about the multi-generational issues that are facing lots of workplace. You have people from, in their 40s and 50s now dealing with millennials in the workforce, and there are communication challenges that are there. Some people are used to speaking on the phone. Others have never picked up a phone and talked to anyone in their lives. Some people actually use email. Some only use text. And this goes on internally. And we want to set an environment that everyone can connect the same way within the company. And these challenges are so important because just as it is with connecting with those clients and establishing those relationships, even more so, we need to have that with the people that are helping to work with us, senior people, junior people, people of all different levels of an organization, and having that sense of a community internally in the company comes from really strong connections. So all the things that I talk about regarding the connecting core are equally important when it comes to connecting to those within your company. So the same lessons of, having a strong why, being authentic, being fearless, and having a really good sense of empathy for your peers is just as important as your targets.
Wow. And this brings to mind, because we spoke before the interview where I said I work with a number of consulting clients. Many of them who own the company might be my age or older, but they're hiring more and more a lot of millennials. And there's sometimes that disconnect of understanding how each of them communicate. Now, what I've come across is I can understand maybe internally letting your millennial folks, you know, kind of communicate with you via texting or such. But how do you deal with it where, say, you have employees that you need for them to get on the phone, but they're just not comfortable with that? What would you suggest to employers?
It is funny, right? Because I one time did this is a true story, actually. This goes back before I was working at Thrive. This worked out when I worked on Wall Street on a trading floor. We had some millennials in the workforce. You can use lots of electronic communications from Bloomberg to instant message and chats. And you could also obviously pick up the phone and speak directly to your clients.
Yeah.
And we actually did an analysis of some of these great salespeople who fit the descriptions that you just did for the millennials and then the senior folks. And the senior folks were talking on the phone all day long, talking to their clients. And the millennials were never even opening their mouths. They were just typing away and sending all these messages.
Yeah.
And where one might have been covering many more clients at once using electronic communication versus being able to only speak one-to-one, they both could benefit from each other, by the way. I want to make this clear that millennials could learn to speak a little bit more on the phone and work on that skill set. Uh-huh. Christina, you and I are around the same age. I find it ironic that, like, when we were younger in high school, you know, talking with boyfriends and girlfriends was job training. No one would ever have thought that, you know, speaking on the phone would actually build those skills. However, on the flip side to that argument, there are certain things that the newer communication means are important too for other people who aren't used to doing that. Emails, you know, quick messages and whatnot. There's a balance between the two.
Yeah.
And it's really important that the younger generation, and I don't like to label them as millennials because no one ever labeled me when I came into the workforce. This is when they came to the workforce. This is who they are. They're brilliant. They're hardworking. They learn quicker than most people.
Yeah.
They have the ability to pick up and practice this. Like anything else, you have to practice speaking on the phone. You have to practice speaking in person. And guess what? Senior people can also practice sending emails, text messages, using proper grammar. All of this is important, but this is all about knowing what our customers and our clients want.
Yeah.
If you end up dealing with, I mean, let's put it this way, there are some companies out there that are run by 26, 27-year-old millennials, and that's what they're used to.
Yeah.
So understanding what the needs, even from a communication point of view, of your target and your client that you're going to connect with, you ask them what they like to hear. Do you like email? Do you like phone? Do you like text? What's the best way to reach you? Understanding all of that is important. So it isn't just you need to know how to do it with an email.
Yes.
You need to know how to do all these forms of communication as it caters to how you're going to connect with your target.
Yeah. And it's been so revolutionary to Savvy and to my business, being able to add these different forms of communication. I mean, when I got started, it was phone only and email perhaps. Right. When I started Savvy, people would say to me, I've tried texting you and you didn't answer me for more than 48 hours. What's your problem? So then I now added a texting number for people just to text, and that's my 732 number. And now I find it to be an awesome tool, and I'm the email queen, people call me. I don't like paper anymore. It's way too messy. But I love doing the phone in tangent with email or texting so that I have the written along with the phone, and like we all have, we're on the same page. We have two forms of communication for everything so that there's no way that we didn't understand each other. So I've kind of learned to love using all the forms of communication. And you're definitely right. To be able to use as many as possible means you can connect with that many more people.
It's a balance too. Never using one too much of anything.
Yes.
If you're just sending emails, that means you're not talking to your clients enough. If you're only talking on the phone, you're not speaking to enough of your clients and your targets.
Yes.
So it's a balance. That's what you need to work on.
Yes, yes. And absolutely, I'm working on it continually myself. I think one big slip for me, I don't know about people you've worked with, was when I first started my business, is really spending way too much time on social media, which is yet another way to communicate with your customers. Yeah. And I loved it with Twitter, Facebook, Google. It's been a great way to connect with people, and people talk and communicate with all the shows and such. But having that balance with not making that an all-day event and not focusing on the rest of your business.
I'll say as an entrepreneur running a company just like you, it's hard to keep up with. There's so many mediums of them. You know, you got to update. At least the tools have become easier where you can send it out from one location and it could blast out to all the different mediums. It's it's challenging. And it's important because there's so many different ways that people are comfortable connecting with you.
How would you decide if you were talking to someone contacted you, they want to hire you, how do you help them get in gear with understanding what their clients' needs are and what they need? Because everyone's target or client are going to need different needs. How do they even begin to discover that?
You know, it sounds so simple, but the real thing you need to do is ask. You have to speak to your clients and literally ask them what is their preferred way to work with them. And a lot of people are afraid, whether we talk about some of the fears that people have, just being able to ask that person what they feel like, they feel is stepping forward to try and do business with them, to try to understand what their needs are. That's the first step. Ask them what they want and then ask for permission even to ask for them.
Wow.
That's a great way to connect. Too often you'll come in and someone say, you know, what's your email? Or what's the best, you know, I'm going to reach you later. Can I call you later? You know, may not be appropriate for you. How about a simple, hey, is it okay if I reach you later today? Is that okay? Yes. Great. Yeah. Those are the types of things that people should be asking permission for, because that actually is part of that whole connecting core and working on connecting with people is to take into consideration them, step into their shoes and that power of empathy.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, this has been fascinating. I don't want us to leave without everyone finding out where they can get in contact with you, find out more about you, work with you, share that with them.
So we'll work backwards here from social media.
Okay.
On Twitter and Facebook, it's at Thrive, T-H-R-I-V-E, Lou D. And on LinkedIn, I'm available there as well. And the website for Thrive is thrivepartners.net. And pretty much if you search for Lou Diamond, just about anywhere, you'll find me across the Thrive landscape from our website and everything, which is going to be up real soon. Actually, it's under construction right now and we'll be up and running within a few weeks. So with all of that, and if you want to buy the book, Master the Art of Connecting, it's available on Amazon, and you can even go to thrivepartners.net, and it'll bounce you right to the link for the book.
Fabulous. Well, this has been so instrumental and wonderful. Thank you so much, Lou, for coming to share your great gifts and wisdom today on Savvy Business Radio.
Christina, thank you for having me.
The Smarter App Company private labels mobile apps, helping businesses leverage content in order to create income and referral-generating systems. Let the Smarter App Company create a unique app for your business today. Contact thesmarterapp.com or call 503-528-4973.